Good morning, church. Shall we all stand? In 1 John chapter 3, verse 1, it says, "For what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the children of God." Amen? That we are a chosen generation, that we are a royal priesthood, that we are the beloved of God, that we are the children of God. And that's why we praise and sing and worship. Hallelujah!
Hosanna!
Praise the Lord!
is amazing today. He withholds no good thing from us. We are His children. He's our shepherd. What a good shepherd He is to us. He gives us, He crowns us with beautiful righteousness. He gives us a spirit of joy and takes away despair. But the oil of gladness for His spirit of mourning today. He puts joy in our hearts today.
Thank you.
Between 5 o'clock to 6:30, we have Applied Bible Doctrine Part 3, ABD Part 3, taught by Pastor John and then later by Pastor Fred. So that's happening on Wednesday. It's a new time slot before our midweek service. Then after that, on Friday, we have Church History taught at 7 p.m. by yours truly. Okay. Then on Saturday, we don't have a class. But on Sunday after church service, we have church ministry, leadership and administration taught by Pastor John, 12:40 to 2 p.m., another speed credit class. So amazing classes, and we all begin this new semester on July the 14th. You can mark that down on July the 14th. We will start registrations and we encourage you all. And if you're not sure on what class to take, I encourage you to just speak to one of our pastors and they will help you out and guide you which classes. But really amazing classes, as you can see, being offered this semester. Moving on to the month of August. Well, what's happening in August? Any guesses? We have the camp here, Eagle Tourism Place. So, there are the dates. The young adults is having a camp August 12th to August 14th. Okay, and that is the Monday to Wednesday. Okay, kids are excited already. Fantastic. Okay, so that's 2,000 rupees. Okay, 12th to the 14th of August. And then following that, you have the family camp. That's 14th of August to the 17th of August. That's 3,000 rupees. Now, this takes care of your accommodation and your food. Okay, travel is extra. And if for young adults who want to do both, that is the young adults camp as well as the family camp, it would be at least 5,000 from the 14th to the 17th, that entire week. Okay, so this is something to make note of.
One verse, Revelation 3:20, Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and I will eat with him and I'll supper and drink with him." So this was written to the church. We often apply it to non-believers. We'll have communion, and it's if you are a Christian, if you have brought Jesus Christ into your heart, then this is really a symbol of that. And if you haven't asked Jesus Christ into your heart, and he will say, he will come in if you ask. And also for believers, just during this time, Jesus said, "I stand at the door and knock. If any man opens the door, I'll come in and sup with him and eat with him." And it's the whole idea of communion is close fellowship. It is the close fellowship with Jesus Christ and close fellowship with the body of Christ. And when Jesus says he's going to come into our heart, I was saying, I mean, but when he's here, so go. Yeah, Indian people get on pretty well with one another generally, because you kind of, if you don't, so many people, you're going to have hard times. So you're kind of learning how to get along with each other. And when you take Christ into your heart, it's pretty close quarters. And, you know, he dwells in our heart. And he says, you know, we've got to put away all anger and wrath and malice and envy and jealousy and pride. And so just at the time when we'll have a song, pray. And if there's in your heart pride, Christ lives in there and he has to live with that. If there's in your heart jealousy and anger, Christ has to live with that. And so we confess our sin. And just at one point, he says, "Confess our sins, and he's faithful and just to forgive and cleanse us." But just confess our sins. Don't whine about them or moan about them. Just, "I'm proud. I think too highly of myself. I'm arrogant and proud." It's just the way it is. And he'll wash us. We don't have to moan our sin away. We confess it and he'll wash our sin. And so we just do that during this song. So the Bible, when Jesus said, "I stand at the door, I will come into you, I will come in," as if there's like this two temples, it speaks out in the New Testament. One, our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and Christ has come to live in our body. But the second temple is the church, where he says he builds us together as a temple, and he dwells in us as the body of Christ. So there's actually two temples, and one is our personal communion with Christ, and that you have at home, and that it's so important. Christ said, "I am in your heart." We have that place of home of communion. Shut the door. Jesus said, "Go to the closet, shut the door, and pray in secret, and your Father who sees you in secret will reward you openly." But that ability to go home and shut the door, and shut the world out, and shut Christ in, and have communion is one. And the second is here, when we come together. We have a different, the fullness of Christ dwells in the body. There's a part of our fellowship with Christ you can't have at home. You have to have it. There's a fullness that is in the body of Christ. And what you have at home in your fellowship, in your own personal relationship, you bring it here. It comes. What you have in your heart, in your closet, you bring, and it adds to this table, and it adds to this communion here. And what you have in this communion, you take home, and it enriches God at home. So I will stand and we'll do the communion together. Lord, just thank you, Father, that you have given your Son. And Lord, just on the night he took the bread and he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you." We'll take the bread. Same night he took the cup and said, "This is my blood given for the forgiveness of sins." So we take the cup. Lord, thank you. Thank you for this gift, Christ in us, the hope of glory, and that, Lord, you do come in to dwell with us, to sup with us, to fellowship with us, to bless our service in Jesus' name.
Very briefly, this is the offering. In 1 Chronicles 29 verse 9, 1 Chronicles 29 verse 9, now the context is that the Jewish people are contributing towards the building of their temple. This is what it says: "Then the people rejoiced, for they had offered willingly, because with a loyal heart they had offered willingly to the Lord. And King David also rejoiced greatly." There are these words that just pop out from this one verse: willingly, rejoice, heart. I was thinking that a person can have a worrying heart. You're always worrying about the future, worrying about the past, worrying about finance. You can have a worrying heart. You can have a wandering heart. That is a heart that is never really decisive. It's rather confused. You're just going along, not making decisions. Now the third one would be having a willing heart, where you take decisions for the Lord, that may be taking risks for the Lord, where you take those steps of faith, where you do things out of joy and just serve the Lord wholeheartedly. We could have a worrying heart, we could have a wandering heart, but thank God we in this church have a willing heart, where we want to use what God has given us for His name and for His glory. Amen. Let's pray. Lord God, we want to thank you for all that we have heard, all that we have received so far. Thank you, God, for this time of the offering, that we can participate willingly, cheerfully for your glory, O God. And may all that we collect and continue to be used for your name. In Jesus' name we pray.
All my fears and lying down.
And welcome, Pastor Pino.
Father, we thank you for this beautiful morning you've given to us. And we are here, Lord, to worship you, to hear from you, to give you the sacrifices of our lives, praises. And we pray, Lord, anoint us, Lord. Bless this time as we are going to meditate on your word. And anoint each one of us, Lord. We thank you. We pray for healing. Lord, we send your power, willingness to heal the broken heart, physical healing. We pray. We thank you, Father. Each one of us here. We pray for Pastor Carl. Strengthen him, Father. We pray. We pray for each one of us, Lord, quicken our bodies. The Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead, Lord, is in us. Quicken our bodies, O Lord, promise us. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so it's amazing to be here. And my family is here. One of our church members is here. I was thinking I'm going to talk about the greatness of God, God's greatness, and there was that song was really about the majesty. The word majesty is coming from a Latin word called greatness, great. It uses in earthly people for kings and queens. We use it for your highness, your majesty. When we talk about God, the majesty of God, it brings the greatness of God, but also brings us a worship from the person who approaches God. I was last couple of days and this month I was reading the book of Isaiah, as well as the book of Deuteronomy, and though it is an Old Testament books, but it has an amazing, the living word which speaks to our heart for our situations. And one of the things I was thinking about, the greatness of God. God is so great. Many times I put God in a box. I think, God, you should be like this. Whenever I need, I open the box. Whenever I can carry my God. But sometimes it's then God breaks that box and says, I'm not like that. I'm not like them, totally different. If you read the book of Job, Job had a set thought about God. God is like this. And he was true. But then there is an amazing mystery about God. He breaks himself, Job was totally like he was one. There was no word to express. Read in Job chapter 38, he said, I put my hand in my mind or my mouth. I don't want to speak God. He was so big, so great. I think this is very important. There is a book written by J.B. Phillips. The title is Your God is Too Small. It's an amazing book. Many times we picture God is like a manager, God is like a father, son relationship, God is like a it's different pictures is given in that book, your God is too small. And I think this is very important in our life because the concept about what we believe about God is a direct effect on our life and lifestyle. And this is in the Old Testament, you can see it. God repeatedly says, like, to whom will you compare me? There is none like me. Like, this is an amazing statement which God is making to the people of Israel, those who knew God, those who saw the wonder working of God. And God is saying, but the God of the Bible, that's what this Bible is so amazing. And you know, like I read, and then I come to this point, God, I am nothing. You are so great. Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3 says that, talks about Jesus Christ sitting at the right hand of the majesty. He's far above. It's not talking just at distance. It talks about his greatness. Christ is so great when we understand. He's so great. And in Deuteronomy chapter 4, this is what just wanted to talk some thoughts I was thinking as I was meditating on this chapter, Deuteronomy chapter 4. This is the last words of Moses. He's talking to the new generation who is going to enter into the promised land. And whenever we read the last words or hear the last words of a person, it's so important. Like we were teaching, like in 2 Timothy, and these are the Paul's last words. Someone said, like, whenever you read the Bible or book of the Bible, understand that context. What is the circumstances behind this writing? When I read 2 Timothy, and then we can smell that prison. We can smell that the stinkiness, that dungeon in that Roman Mamertine prison. We can see that. But even in that, like a setting, Paul is writing a victorious letter, talking to these amazing things about this great God. So in Deuteronomy chapter 4, Moses is saying that my time is ended. I am not going to that other part of that country. I am not coming to this promised land. But I wanted to say to you, this is also saying this is a new generation. And he says this verse 32, Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 32. But ask concerning the days that are past, which were before you, since the day that God created man on the earth. As from one end of the heaven to the other, whether any great thing like this has happened or anything like it has been heard. It's amazing. What's the saying to the people? As for the creation of this world, creation of the man, anything like this happened? Is anything like this happened? Like a birth of a new nation? Delivering this new nation? Protecting this new nation of Israel? Is anything like this happened? He's asking this question, and he is giving this warning to these people. Like, beware. Take heed to yourself. If you read Deuteronomy chapter 4, this phrase repeats at least four times. It repeats, beware, take heed to yourself, lest you forget. It's an easy, we can forget what we heard, what we've seen through our God. Moses said, it's a great God. This is a great greatness of God. And when God does these things, it's the greatest show which has happened on this earth. Moses said, is there any things happen like this? Like this? Delivering these people, 6 millions of people, through that wilderness, terrible journey. It was not a mob. It was like an orderly arrangement. People are going in an order. Like, it's amazing. That's in Numbers chapter 23. People came to curse these people. And they saw. This is not a mob. Like, they had a special arrangement. They had a law. They had a statue. They had the statue of me. There's a the God has given them the word of God. God says in Deuteronomy chapter 4, is there any nation is like this? God has given his word, God has given his law. Is there any nation? Can you search out? It's amazing. You say that God, no. This is the greatness of God. God's greatness. Because sometimes we can bring God with you. Little God. I want God according to my concept. I want God to be do like this. God breaks it. God breaks that concept about himself in my life. In Isaiah chapter 26, God said, I'm going to do a marvelous work. I'm going to do a wonderful work in this nation. That's amazing when you read that chapters, maybe you see that. In Psalm 115, God says to the people, David is saying that, like people make idols, meaning not just a material things maybe, but I can make my own concept about God, I can make an idol in my own heart. God says they have hands, they cannot handle. They have thoughts, they cannot mutter a voice. They have eyes, they cannot see. They have ears, they cannot hear. Though, the verse 8 of Psalms 115 says, those who make them also be like them. Because I want God in my way. I want God to be, don't question me, I'm right. Don't tell me what is right or wrong. Don't tell me this is evil or this is good. Isaiah 5:20 says, woe to those people who call evil good, good evil. This is the greatest shock which has happened on this planet Earth. When I think about, like, we in our Bible college, we teach us, yes, it says about a dispensation, meaning the word which comes from the Greek word, oikonomia. From that word, English word came, economy. Oikonomia, meaning house affairs. God today conduct his house affairs through the church. When you read in the Old Testament, God was dealing with it through the, dealing this world through Israel. But today, God is dealing. Today, this is a nation, holy nation. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. God is today dealing. God is declaring his presence, his glory, his greatness through the church, through this, like, each born again believer. That's why he said in Isaiah 26:21, I will do a marvelous work. Even if I declare, you will not believe. Isaiah chapter 29, verse 14. It says that, like, this is a wonderful work. This is a marvelous work God is doing. Because he is not limited. He is an eternal. In the Old Testament, when God expressed himself, he uses this human terms. He has arms, he has eyes, he has ears. And it's called the anthropomorphisms to explain about himself in human language. But there's a danger sometimes. I think God is like me. No. There's no limit. God is so personal. But there is no limit to God. He is a wonderful, wonder working God. No limit in the knowledge. No limit in the power. No limit in his presence. He is everywhere. He is everywhere. God has not limited. This is an amazing thing. Like Isaiah, book of Isaiah, I say that, like, this is what God. Isaiah was a prophet. And he is prophesying to a nation which is prosperous, because there was a prosperity all over the country. There was no threatening of war. There is no poverty. There is nothing. Okay, we are satisfied by ourselves. Christ is saying that there is a danger. Because of prosperity, because there is nothing, danger, there is a prosperity, there is a danger. That is, you have a wrong concept about God. Wrong concept. Isaiah says, Lord, I am unclean, I am an unclean man. So what is this greatest show which is happening today? I'm thinking about the church. Paul says in his Ephesians chapter 3, he says that this mystery which was hidden, but now made manifest to us, to the prophets, to the apostles, through the Holy Spirit. Church is the greatest mystery, where the Gentiles are partakers, where the Gentiles far off, but now we are joined into the kingdom of God. That's amazing. 1 Samuel chapter 2, it says that, is a prayer of the Hannah. She says that God raises the poor. God lifts the beggar from the dunghill and to set them among the princes. Think about those verses. It's a powerful verses. God raises the poor. The word poor means like he's hanging between eternity, eternal life or death. The poor means he does not have any capacity to walk himself. He is a broken. Yeah, God raises up that man. God lifts the beggar from the dungeon and to set them among the princes. This is amazing work God has, because he's a great God. I think God, you should not do this way. No, don't touch that. He's a poor, he's a beggar, don't lift that. This is what happens in this world. But God says, this is a marvelous work which I'm doing. What is another marvelous work which God does? I was thinking about the preaching of the gospel. This is an amazing privilege, but God is using us to proclaim His goodness, His grace into this world. Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah is standing before God and saying, Lord, I am an unclean man. How can I preach? God said, you will preach, you can preach. This Bible says that God has sanctified him, cleansed him, and he went to the preaching and the missions. And this is amazing. God has given this privilege. Everyone. It's not about that, like I am perfect or in a experience me. Many times this thought comes, you are struggling in this area, and how you are going to preach this? God said, this is a marvelous work. This is a marvelous work which God has given. That's why Paul said in Ephesians chapter 6, this is a mystery which is hidden, which I am proclaiming this gospel. Paul says that, you know my, like, you see my knowledge in this gospel, Paul says in Ephesians chapter 3, as if Paul is boasting about that. I was thinking, why Paul is boasting in that Ephesians chapter 3? He says, Lord, you see, whenever you read my epistle, you know my knowledge in this subject. You know, he's not boasting in that sense. Whenever we say that, okay, there's a good restaurant, there's a good food, cheap food, whatever it is. When we say to our friends, we are not boasting about it. We are saying that you can also go there. You can. I want you to enjoy that. That's what exactly Paul is saying. He said, this is a great mystery, the mystery of the gospel of grace. I want we to enjoy, Paul is saying that you want to enjoy this grace and to proclaim this gospel to the people. Ephesians 3:10 says that, this is another great verse. Through the church, we are teaching angels and this world the manifold wisdom of God. You know that when we sit here, when we walk, like we are the greatest show the world is seeing. They may not understand, but the angels and the principalities, they are learning the manifold wisdom of God. It's amazing. Paul says, because of this, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 9, he says that we are apostles. We made spectacles, public spectacles to this world and to the angels. So that the word, the spectacle, he says that we are an open theater. The word in Greek is called a theater. We are theaters to the angels and to this world. That's amazing. Like we can grumble, we can talk about all the negative things in this world. Who should come to the government, whatever it is. We are like, people are discussing about the election results and whatever it has happened. I believe church has more power, authority. But the Bible also says, Romans chapter 13, as believers, we need to submit to the every authority. By doing that, we are displaying the manifold wisdom of God. It feels like we are like a weak, but God says, this is the way. In the first century, Christians were treated very, very cruelly. They considered Christians are very weak, outcast, no use. But then this virtue, this quality came out of the humility. Humility came out because of they followed the example of Christ. I think this is the Paul says, like when we submit to the authority, when we submit to one another, submit to the authority which is outside or inside, whatever it is, like we are displaying the manifold wisdom of God, the presence of God. Yeah, we can talk all about that, negative things, we can talk about a leader or a ruler, but that's common. What is the greatest show? When you submit to that authority, that's not a common show. This is the greatest show which is happens. When Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 2, he says that submit to the authorities. When he says that, like we can say that in any government, we are submitting to the authority. When Peter says that he is under a Nero, young, cruel Roman emperor, like the death bell is ringing on the Christians, but he says that submit to the emperor or to the governors. That's amazing. This is the greatest show when we submit to one another. What is another greatest show? You know that Paul says to the Corinthians, who had a lot of problems in the church, he said to the church, be steadfast, be immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain. Work of the Lord, doing the work of the Lord is amazing. You can find out. This is amazing. Angels of worship, unseen world, good angels, elect angels, fallen angels, all are worshiping. Because Paul says that be steadfast, having a conviction, this immovable conviction in our own heart. Always abounding. When we look at Pastor Carl, always abounding, enthusiastic, always abounding in the work of the Lord. There's one atheist was early morning, he was going to hear a preacher. And one of his friends said, you don't believe in God, why are you going? He said, I don't believe in God, but the preacher does. He preaches with that passion. He preaches as if he really believes God. That's amazing. I think George Whitefield was a preacher. The people used to go early morning with the candle. Because they, whenever a person goes in the early morning, the candle, that day, they knew that they are going to hear George Whitefield. They love to hear that man who was with a passion, was like a burning candle, burning light, like Apostle, like John the Baptist. Work of the Lord. It's not in vain. I can get weary, I can get discouraged. Paul says in 2 Timothy, he says that I am in prison. Nobody is with me. Everyone forsaken me. You know that there was one man in that story. His name is called Onesiphorus. It's amazing. This young girl, I don't know, young girl, like this man, he came. He looked at Paul. Paul is in prison, no address, only you, Paul, the missionary, preacher, apostle, he is in prison, sentenced to death, he can die any time. But this man went throughout all the Roman area, maybe those city, to find out where the Paul is. And Paul was, in the last letters, he says, this man refreshed my soul. This man refreshed me. It's like a cold water in a hot sunny day. This man refreshed on his cross. And may the Lord grant mercy to him in that day. That's what Paul's prayer. This is amazing. I don't have to be discouraged. But even if discouragement comes, I can bring it to this great God. Great God, I can bring it. That's what the book of Psalms talks all about. He brings his problems, then make it a psalms. I think Pastor Stephen said, what is the definition of spirit-filled life? He said, bring your problems to God and make it a psalm. That's amazing. This is amazing. When we are bringing, we are going to God. God, this is what. Paul said that my first defense, nobody stood with me. But there is a man who came, who searched diligently for me. He came and he found me and he refreshed my soul. Maybe he refreshed Paul. And he maybe is, Paul, there is some cold water or some juice or whatever it is, like that presence really ministered to God. This is the greatest work which is God is doing in our life. That's why Paul says that. Like in the book of Habakkuk, chapter 3 says, even though fig tree may not blossom, there may not be flocks in the sheepfold, yet I will rejoice. Yet I will rejoice. Because our work in the Lord is not going to be vain. Every step is counted, every tear is bought. Every money which we have given to God in cheerful heart, have it been rewarded. Every message which we preach to the unsaved as an end result, whether leading them to the eternal life or put them in an accountability before God, it is not in vain. That's what our gathering is not in vain. As the day of the Lord is approaching, Hebrews chapter 10 says that, do it all the more. This is amazing. This is because of God is so great. Deuteronomy chapter 4, God talks about one more thing. God said, I am a jealous God. I am a jealous God. That's amazing. He's a jealous God. You're following this jealous God. It's totally different. He wants our love. He wants our devotion. If any other things are taking place, he says, I am a jealous God. I will break that box. So that I want your total devotion, total attention to myself. I am a jealous God. God says that. Because he loves us. He loves us. Maybe they say, what is the difference between a Western movie like love and the Eastern, like a Hollywood love? Is it only one word? Trees. Like trees. Like in the Hollywood movies, all love is all about trees. I think this is but God's love is bigger than. Is it displayed on that tree? On the cross. It's amazing. God said, I loved you. There is no other nation like this. There is no other nation who has a word, who has God has spoken, but still you are living. Read this chapter, Deuteronomy chapter 4, and this is amazing ministry to you, and that is amazing how God really is. Like, think about this, a great God. Great God. Like, whenever, like, Martin Luther said to one man, said, your God is too human. There's no divine. Your God is too human, too little. But Martin Luther said, whenever I don't understand the Bible, I just lift the hat. Like he was wearing a wig, right? Lift the hat, lift the cap. I said, God, I don't understand, but I know you are a great God. It's amazing. Because otherwise, these small things can displace. Small things that displace our great God. I know God. I know God is going to do like this. I know this is where we should happen. But I believe God's way is amazing. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. Let's pray. Father, we come to you, the great Lord, who does wonderful things. The psalmist says, your way is in the sea. And you let the people of Israel, 6,000 people maybe. But Lord, you led them in a way which no one ever passed through that way. Lord, as we today walk in this journey of faith, journey of life, sometimes, Lord, there is a terrible bitterness. We pray today. Help us to see you, your word, to hear your word. Lord, we pray today. Young people, older people, middle-aged, we pray. you need your love, you need your greatness, your the revelation about your greatness. Psalm 48 verse 1, great is the Lord, greatly to be praised. Great. You are so high, God. Yes, God. We pray today. Help each one of us, God, in this walk of faith. To know you more. As Paul said, that I may know him. I may know him. Lord, speak to our hearts. In this journey, in our decisions making, maybe life comes to a junction where we don't know what to do. We pray, you are a great God. All things work together for good to those we love. I thank you, Father. Thank you for doing a great work, Lord, in our lives, in this church, and in many other places. Thank you for your faithfulness. Even if we are faithless, we are a faithful God. This is a great God. Thank you. At this point, if anybody in this room will never receive Jesus as your personal Savior, you can receive right now. There is no other Savior like this who came this earth, took the form of a boy, a slave, servant, lived, and died for our sins, and the third day he was raised, is alive forevermore. If we believe in Jesus today, say this simple prayer, Jesus, I believe, forgive my sins, give me eternal life. I mean, if you do this prayer, the Bible declares, guarantees, you are a child of God, your sins are forgiven. There is an assurance that you are the child of God. Lord, we thank you once again for this. Jesus' name we pray.
Now I'm saying message. We're just thinking about the majesty of God. Let's gather some thoughts that Pastor Peter just shared. I was thinking about, you can't put God in a box. He's much bigger than our thoughts. He's much bigger than our ways. I was also thinking, another thought that they shared was, when you go through situations in your life and you bring it to God and turn it around to a psalm, you know, that's amazing that we could bring it to God. Even I was thinking, as this message was pondering, I was thinking about in Luke chapter 5, we shared this Wednesday, that Peter didn't catch any fish. And Jesus comes to him and says, launch out deep, go again. It's the middle of the day, why don't you go again? But too impossible, like as Peter could think, two impossibilities there. One is nobody goes in the midday to catch fish. And a carpenter is telling a fisherman how to fish. In both these places it's impossible. But our God is a God of impossible, isn't it? And Peter goes and catches fish. God was showing Peter, he's not only to catch the fish, he's in charge of the fish. He's in charge of the oceans. I think sometimes we could be so natural and so little and put God in our box the way we wanted it. But he cannot fit in that box. He's much bigger. He's much bigger than our minds could even contain them. So today, as we think about this week, as we go with these thoughts and really ponder upon these thoughts, there's nothing that God cannot do. Like the songs that we sang, He is the healer. He is a God who never changes. He is a God who cannot lie. He is a God who can turn your things around. He says to do things that are impossible and make it possible. So let's pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you for the beautiful word that we heard today. Thank you for ministering to us today. Thank you for opening our eyes. Lord, you are beyond our minds, Lord. Your ways are higher than our ways. Your thoughts are higher than our thoughts, Lord. We thank you. Lord, we thank you. We just see a part of this earth, but in one day we will see in the whole, and it will be beautiful. It will be beautiful what is stored for us in heaven. Thank you, Jesus, for the beautiful heaven, the mansions. There's joy, there's no sicknesses, there's no trials, there's no disappointments there. Lord, you are a God, you are a big God, and you have stored big things for us. Lord, we love you today, we love you so much today. Lord, there's anybody here today, Lord, there's something that in your heart you are burdened to, and give it to God, you see, this morning, give it to God, trust Him, He's faithful. He's faithful. He remains faithful. Give it to Him. There's maybe a sickness, maybe a trial, maybe a situation in your marriage, maybe a financial situation that you're going through. Give it to God. He is able. He makes everything possible. Lord, we also thank you for our pastor today. Just touch him today. Encourage him. Build him up, Father. Quicken his body. Heal him. Thank you. Give him a great week this week, Father. We thank you. Thank you for His labor, Lord. His love, Lord. We thank you. We worship you, Lord. Give us a tremendous, awesome week. Getting to know you much deeper way, Lord. Give us great times and mornings with you, Lord. Help us to fellowship with you this week. Thank you. We praise you. Bless our body today. Bless each one of us today. Even as we go back throughout this week, protect us. And let your hand be upon us, your good hand be upon us, your favor go before us like you showed Nehemiah your favor. Show us this week, Father, that you're a good, good Father. We love you, we praise you. In Jesus' name.